Hello and welcome to Canguro English. This is another live English class. My name is Christian and I'm extremely happy to be your teacher today. Well, teacher, to be your guide. Today we are going to play lots of games. We're going to be playing lots of games, which I think is absolutely the best way to learn anything, not just language, but anything in life. Learn by doing, learn by playing. So before I start, I just want to say that if you want to support free English education, then there are two ways you can do that. The first way is you can buy some very stylish Canguro English merchandise. Or you can become my patron on Patreon. The links for all of those things you will find on my website, kangarooenglish.com. And also below, links below. I'm quite happy today because today is the first day that I have felt normal for maybe 10 days. For the past 10 days, I've had this horrible virus. I don't know, I felt not myself, which is not good. Today I feel normal. I'm back. And I recorded a new episode of my podcast this morning. You can go and listen to that. I'm going to go for a run this afternoon for the first time in a long time. So it's good. It's a good day. Okay, hello to everybody. We have Raja or Raya Hussein, Tony Ward, Hisham, Linlin, Christina Ruibal, Nona Nona, Ketal Meriam El Batul, Ariana Samaun, Celeste, I see what you did there, Luis Lopez, Susan Taleb, Jan Kowalski, Feder Dawala Chahi, Gosha's here, Elik, Yura, Advaldo, too many people, a lot of people. And I think today the camera's not flipped. Oh no, it is flipped. Is that backwards? Damn it. Why is it backwards? Okay, no problems. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. No problems. Okay, let's start with a little game to warm up. Okay, we're going to warm up with a little game. Okay, so this game is called, it's called adjective. Oh, I can't write on the board. Okay. Okay, this game is called adjective, noun, and verb. So I'm going to do a drawing on the board and you have to tell me the adjective and the noun and the verb, the three things. Okay, here we go. So, okay, we'll start with an easy one. An easy one. Okay, here we go. Okay. something like this, no? Okay. Who can tell me what we have here? We have, so I need the adjective and the noun and the verb. So what is it and what is it doing and how is it feeling, basically? So does anybody know the name of this thing? This thing? It's like a dog cat. And yes, it is a very famous Scottish musical instrument. Very good. Kellyanne D. Kellyanne D is the first person to put the correct word. Now, you know, in English, we're very literal. You know, we're very literal people. So it's a bag with pipes for music. Literally, we call them bagpipes. 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 A bag of pipes. So, does anyone know the verb? What verb do we use with these? Ooh, so Roberta Xavier says it's a hedgehog. A hedgehog playing beautiful bagpipes. Yeah, so you could use the verb bagpiping, but it's more natural to say play. So it's playing bagpipes. Yes, my drawing is probably worse than yours. My drawing is worse than most people's. But what's the adjective for the hedgehog? How's the hedgehog feeling, do you think? How is it feeling? He's happy! Exactly. Okay, so he's a happy animal playing bagpipes, but he's not a hedgehog. Does anybody know there's an animal similar to a hedgehog that's not a hedgehog. Does anybody know the name of this animal? Kirby. It's not Kirby. It's not a peacock. Peacocks are more beautiful. It's not Sonic. Rogelia otico. Very nice. It is a porcupine. A porcupine. Now, the history of this word is quite interesting. So maybe if you speak another European language, like if you speak Italian or French, maybe you recognize this pork, right? Pork. Well, in so basically, literally, porcupine means a spiny animal. So basically, literally, and this word also is related to this word. Porcelain, which is a material to make bowls and plates, porcelain. And the relationship between porcelain and porcupine and pigs and something else, it's very, very surprising and shocking. And I recommend that you Google the etymology of the word porcelain. It's very surprising. In Italy, in Tuscany in particular, God is called pork.
Really?
Wow. I suppose that God is maybe some type of animal like anything else, right? Maybe a human animal, maybe a ghost animal. Who knows? Who knows? Okay. We're going to do... Actually, no, we're not going to do any more. Today, there are three things I want to do with you. I hope I have time to do all of them, okay? Three things. So, the first thing is that we are going to talk about something called binomials, okay? Binomials. It's a fancy word, but it's not complicated, okay? Binomials. Something like that. Ay, 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 with the backwards N every time. This is very frustrating. Okay, binomials. Binomials means two. Okay, so we have two words. Two words. That's all it means. Okay? Binomials means two words. So they're two words that go together naturally, right? And they exist in lots of languages, not just English. Now, why do we use two words when we can use one word for emphasis? Binomials are used for emphasis, for giving that extra power to the things that you say. So they're good, they're fun, they're interesting. And because binomials are fixed, sometimes they contain words that are older words, words that we don't use every day in English, words that now are fossils, okay? So let's look at some very common binomials, okay? So, now, imagine that we are talking about the secret to a good relationship. What's the secret to a happy relationship, or the secret to a happy marriage? Tell me, I'm curious, what do you think? Danielle Senpai says money. Claim says arguments. Arguments. Sanket says arguments. Jashek says love. Alcohol. I think you're right. Sometimes a gin and tonic is absolutely necessary. Dennis says patience. Kwasai Hussein says harmony, truth, respect, confidence. Absolutely. And there's a binomial, I think. There's a binomial as well. So there's two words that we can use to describe this, okay, which is this. Does anybody know the second part of this binomial? If you want a happy relationship, you need give and give and take. Very good, guys. Give and take. Oops. Give and take. So this is an example of a binomial. So the two words come together with one meaning, and we have an and in the middle, give and take. Okay? Now, sometimes they don't sound similar, but normally the sounds of the two words are very important. Like here we have one syllable, give and take. They have a similar rhythm. But normally with a binomial, The important thing is alliteration. Normally the first letter is the same, or we have the same sound, right? Let's look at another one. What about, okay. Now, I don't know if you have the same stereotype in your country, but in Anglo-Saxon culture, you know, in Britain and America, we have the stereotype of the librarian. You know, the woman or the man who works in the library. The stereotype is normally it's a woman, right? It's a woman. Now, how would you describe this woman who works in the library, who's shh, shh, you know, maybe she has glasses and she has her hair here in a bun and she has the buttons all the way to the top, right? Ooh, very nice. So Chandra says she's a bookworm. Sorrel is imagining the sexy librarian. That's such a great, that's like an alternate stereotype. Personally, I've never seen this in reality, but Ragad says that she's quiet and bossy. Bossy, great word, bossy. Angry, strict, classic. Jack dated her once. Which one, the sexy librarian or the other librarian? It's serious, crazy, boring. Okay, so we have a binomial to describe a person who is kind of strict and traditional and classic and, okay? And it starts with PR. So the first part of the binomial is prim. Prim. Prim describes the way that they look. Conservative, traditional, with the buttons all the way up to the top. Prim. Now, this is an example of a word that is not very common now in English, but it survives, it lives in this binomial. But the question is, what's the second part of the binomial? Prim and what? Now remember, we have the same sound. The same sound, the repetition of the sound is important. Very nice, Chandra, very nice. Now, without looking at Chandra's post, what's a word that's like a synonym for correct, for straight, for serious? Very good. A lot of you guess. So we have, yes, Arjeta, Arjeta, Lina da Silva, Jas, who else? Kusai, Sorrel, Hitchin, very good. It's prim and proper. Prim and proper. This is the classic librarian. The librarian is prim and proper. She's prim and proper. Shh, be quiet. Okay. Let's do another one. Now, if we have somebody who is prim and proper, what about somebody who is the opposite on the other end of the spectrum? Somebody whose clothes are disheveled, right? Someone who is disheveled. This is a great word, disheveled. We stole this word from the French, because disheveled is means a déchevel, means your hair is crazy, right? Yeah. So a disheveled person, but it's like an attitude. It's an attitude, okay? And I'll give you a clue. It's something and something. Okay, now, does anybody know a word that starts with R that means kind of like messy? You know, messy. Not the footballer, messy. Not Leonardo Messi. Messy, as in messy, right? Who knows a word with R? And this word is also commonly used when you are writing a paper, when you are making a draft of a paper. Ooh, very nice, guys, very nice. Fabrizio was the first one. Fabrizio Montalegre. Then we had Rostem Shaimuratov, and also Olga Onishuk. Ofgon Music was there too. Very good, very good. It is rough. Rough. So we have this repetition of the rough and... Okay, so we know that the person is a bit disheveled. They're a bit rough. But they are also happy like this. They are prepared for action. Like, they look bad, but they are out of the house, on the street. They're doing things. Very good, Lena da Silva. Very good. They are rough and ready. Rough and ready. So, if you go to the library, the librarian is prim and proper. And all of those third year degree students at the university are all rough and ready. they're studying, which is actually what they're not doing, is studying. They're doing something called cramming. Now, this maybe is an important verb for you, right? As people who have to study hard to you know, advance your language, right? So cram is a verb. It means to study intensely, normally when it's too late, normally at the last minute. This is typical, I think. People who go to university, the first 6 months of the year, maybe they go to the classes, maybe not. Maybe they go out with their friends a lot. And then a month before the exams, they cram. So, because cram also means to put a lot of things in a small space. You could say, we went to a party and we were crammed. So many people. It's like with your exams, you're cramming all this study. EJ, you're a funny guy. You're a funny guy. You should work as a clown. I think that would be a great job for you, a clown. Everlax has a great question here. What about rough and tough? So that's another example, right, of another binomial. Rough and tough, it's a little bit different. You know, rough and tough, rough and strong. And that repetition of the sound, it just sounds good, right? For the emphasis, it sounds great. Okay. Ooh. Okay, now let's go back to our relationship. Let's go back to the secret of a happy marriage, the secret of a good relationship. Now, part of that may be, you know, giving flowers or giving chocolates, or what other things can you do that are romantic? Tell me, what other romantic things can you do that to help your relationship to survive? Yeah, so kissing, yes, flowers, ooh, traveling. Yes, traveling's very important. Going to dinner, diamonds, well, a ring to make out. Jashek says strawberries and an ice cream. No, strawberries and chocolate, very good. Jokes, cars. Giving cars. Oh, Brandon says cuddling. I don't know how many of you know this word. Okay, so we have a hug. Okay, so a hug in English is like, okay, hug and finished. It's like a moment. You go, you hug, big hug for you, and then it's finished. But we have another thing, which is cuddle. Cuddle. Cuddle is different because cuddle is a long period, right? So maybe you sit with your partner, your girlfriend or your boyfriend, and you cuddle. It's like a long hug. It's a hug. It's a hug that can continue for 10 hours. And it's a great, so it's a noun and a verb, like to hug and to cuddle, or give a hug or give a cuddle. It's a very important word. And it doesn't have to be romantic. You can cuddle your dog, or you can cuddle your mum or dad, or you can cuddle your baby. Yeah? Okay? Okay. So, sorry, I got distracted. Okay, so, yes, one thing you could do to help your relationship is to go out and do something romantic. And when you go out to a restaurant, you do two things, right? You drink like this. Oops. Drink and eat. Drink and eat. But this sounds very, this doesn't sound very romantic. It doesn't sound. Jack, you're right. The alcohol is super important. So, but you know, drinking and eating, it doesn't sound great, right? It's not a great, there's no rhythm. It sounds cheap. You know, you drink and eat at McDonald's, but this is something romantic. You know, this is something you lovely. So what we need synonyms that are special, synonyms that are posh. So, who can tell me a synonym for drink that's more posh, more elegant, that means the same thing? Ooh, Danielle Senpai says sip, a beverage. Ooh, that is a posh word. Cocktail. Okay, a cocktail, yeah. We're on the right track. So think about some different types of alcohol. To toast, okay, to toast is ding. Gulp, no, gulp is this. Horu Horu. I don't know how to pronounce your name. I don't know. Is that your name? Horu Horu? Horu Horu is correct. It is wine. Wine, of course, is can be a verb. To wine somebody means to give them wine. So now, does anybody know what this second word is? The posh word for eat? Arjeta Bekiri. Very, very good. It is to dine. To wine and dine. And maybe this word seems a bit strange at first, but you know, in your house you have a dining room, which is where you eat. You know, and dine now as a verb, it's very posh. It's very posh. So we only use it in this situation to wine and dine. Very important to wine and dine. Ginger ale says that you can also dine and dash. Dine and dash. I'll tell you a little story, an incredible story, okay? So there was in Spain, this happened in Spain, okay? There was this big family of gypsies, okay? So they were people who, you know, they were living in caravans and they had no fixed address. They were gypsies. And they would go to a restaurant and say, okay, we want to have a party. It's for me and 200 people. We want a party for 200 people. We want food and drinks and music. We want everything. And so the restaurant says, wow, of course, no problems. Fantastic. So the restaurant organizes this big meal with drinks and music and so all of these gypsies go to the restaurant to eat and drink, and they're there for hours eating great food and drinking, and then suddenly they all disappear. It's unbelievable. They just very carefully, very quickly, they're all gone. And so they have consumed thousands, sometimes tens of thousands of euros of food and drink and alcohol, and they disappear. And it was, they did this in, I think, 5 or 6 different restaurants, and then the police finally caught them. But in English, as we say, you cannot get blood from a stone. You can't get blood from a stone. It means that they have no money to give because they were, what can we call them? Peripatetic traveling people, right? So the same way you can't get money from them because they have no money, the same way you can't get blood from a stone because it has no blood. And the word for this in Spanish, the word for when you leave the restaurant, it's a special word. It's called a simpa. A simpa. Because sin means without, or, yeah, without. Without, and pa was an abbreviation of pagar, which means to pay. So in Spanish, to hacer el simpa or la simpa, I don't know if it's masculine or feminine. A simpa is sin pagar, without paying. maybe in other countries it's different. So Rodrigo says in Brazil it's called a calote. What does that mean exactly, a calote? I'd be curious. Celeste is hacerse el gil. un simpa, yeah. Leave without paying. I hope that nobody here has done this. I hope that you are all very morally virtuous people in this class. Okay, let's do another one. Let's do another one. Hello. Wow, we have somebody here. Hello, ciao, salute, hola, hola, hola. It's Rodriguez says, on August 11th, lawyers leave the restaurant without paying. Really? Is that like a tradition? On the 11th of August, the lawyers don't pay? Wow. Amazing. Dia do penduda. Incredible, incredible. Okay, okay, another one. Let's do, Okay. Now, imagine you are at the restaurant with your wife or girlfriend or boyfriend, with your partner, okay? So, Rodrigo says, because of this, lawyers don't go to heaven. there are so many jokes about lawyers and heaven. You should definitely Google lawyer jokes. Okay, so, imagine that you are in the restaurant with your partner, and they're looking at the menu, and they have, in the restaurant, they have an option for a set menu.
Set.
Set, oh, I did it correctly, yes. A set menu, right? So a set menu means that, you know, you have this for the first course, and this for the second course, and this for dessert, and it's fixed, it's a set menu. Set means fixed. Because, you know, you can set your hair, or you can set an alarm. You fix it, you, okay? So the restaurant has set menus. But your partner, you know, your partner is a bit fussy. Fussy. Fussy means a person who is very specific about things, right? Like, you know, a person it's like a fussy eater is a person who only eats specific things. Yes, a synonym would be picky. Picky snicky. Someone who's tikismikis. Right? A fussy person, okay? So your partner is very fussy. Okay? Very fussy. And so when the waiter comes, your partner says, listen, I want the set menu, but can I change the soup for the pasta, and I don't want to change the dessert for the fruit? And the waiter says, no, 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 no. This is a set menu. You cannot. Okay? And so we want two words, we want two synonyms that mean select. To select, right? Oops, no, wait. Select. To select. So we have them already, here they are. Fabrizio Monteleone, it says pick. Monica Miguel says pick. And Dasha says choose. And this repetition for emphasis is the binomial. I did the S backwards.
Damn it.
Yes. To pick and choose. So the waiter says, no, 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 I'm sorry, but you cannot pick and choose. This is a set menu. Now, one thing I forgot to say about binomials is that the order, you cannot change the order. You cannot say choose and pick. You cannot say dine and wine. You cannot say ready and rough. You have to have them in this order. It's similar to one specific piece of vocabulary. So yeah, pick and choose means that you can take what you want. You can mix the menu. Okay. Let's do one more. We're going to do one more. One more. Okay. Now, let's continue the story. I like this story. So they're having a great relationship because they have give and take, and because, you know, they go out and every now and again they wine and dine each other. And, you know, they're very understanding about picking and choosing in the restaurant. And then they're driving home. Okay, they're driving home in the car from the restaurant. I am a little bit today. So driving home from the restaurant, and this part of the city, this part of the town, it's a bit old. It's a little bit decaying. It's a little bit like a little bit dilapidated, tired. The reason is that the government didn't spend any money on fixing the town. The town is, it's a bad condition. So we can say that the town is something and something. We have this, again, we have this repetition of the sound. Now, the first word is now in modern English is dead. Okay, it is rack. Rack. Rack means that something is destroyed. Now, who knows a synonym for something which is destroyed or dilapidated or old or tired? Wow, so Gutenberg says ragged. So, okay, so we have amazing, guys. Amazing. Great work. Kusai Hussein and also Arjeta and Dennis hit the nail on the head. The nail on the head. It is rack and ruin. No, that's not the correct end. My brain does not like to do the thing. Rack and ruin. So rack and ruin is a description of something which is old and tired and rack and ruin. You can use it to describe a person or a building or. No, I'm not dyslexic, but the problem is I have to write backwards because the camera is backwards. Look, I'll show you. See? This is reality. This is what I really look like. And this is what I have to write on the board. Look. I have to write backwards. See? This is what I have to write like a crazy person. So that's what's happening. Yeah, I could use a mirror, but I don't have a huge. I hope that YouTube puts an option Hey, YouTube, here's an idea. Can you put an option so I can... Seriously? Okay. Now, let's move on to part two. Okay, part two. Now, I want to talk about reported speech. Reported speech is when you repeat what the other person said. So it's a bit like, Christian said da 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 da, or you know, Maria said da 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 da. Now, when you use reported speech, you have two options. Okay, two options. You can use direct speech. Direct speech is when I repeat exactly what you say. So, Christian said, hello, my name is Christian. Hello, my... We use the marks, right? Hello, Christian said, hello, my name is Christian. Or, we can substitute the words and make indirect speech. And indirect speech is much more common than direct speech, because direct speech requires imitation. It's not natural in a conversation, right? So today we're focusing on direct speech, okay? So now maybe you already know how to exactly tech designs. Christian said, see you in class. Now maybe you already know how to use direct, indirect speech. Or maybe not, I don't know, right? So let's practice together, okay? So here's my man. Isn't he beautiful? He looks like me. So here's our man, and he's going to tell us something. He's going to say something to us. We'll do an easy one first, okay? So he says, backwards, seriously. Okay, here we go. So he says, I'm living in London. I'm living in London. Now you go to your friend and you say,
oh yeah,
that's the beard for me. Look, we're like brothers. I'm living in London, so... Christian's mother said she is living in London. He said that he is living in London. Okay? I'm going to London. He said he was living in London. My friend said that he lives in London. Trump said I'm living in Singapore. He said he was living in London. Okay, so I can see some variation. And I want to talk about some specific things, okay? So the first thing is this. Now, we need to change this because I know he said, right? Living in London, right? Now, we have the verb. We also have the verb here, right? Now, we have possibilities. We have two possibilities to change. We can use the present tense like this. So we can say is, he is living in London, or we can use the past tense, was. Because he said, this person talked in the past. So there's two possibilities. You can say, he said he is living in London or he said he was living in London. They're both correct. It's not obligatory to transform the verb into the past. It's an option. So why would you use this option? Like, why would you transform the verb into the past sometimes and then into the past another time? Why? Well, native speakers use it to help you to understand the details, to help with your understanding. So if I say, he said he is living in London, I'm helping you to understand that it's continuing now. Like, I know he's continuing to live in London and I'm passing you that information. But maybe I'm not sure if he is, or maybe I know that at that time he was living in London, but now he lives in Mexico. So I can say, he said he was living in London. I'm helping you to maybe understand that maybe now he's not. I'm not sure, okay? So it's absolutely flexible. And think about it as an extra tool, an extra sort of way to help the other person to understand what you're saying. Now, which one is more common? Like, which one should you use? Which one should you use? Well, I have never seen any scientific research about this topic. The textbooks, they always say to do this, to go into the past. And I, you know, my anecdotal observations, my personal observations are that it seems more common, more natural to use the past, okay? But I think that equally I could be totally wrong. It's very dangerous to use your personal observations. It's very important to look at the facts, and I'm not sure of the facts, but I do know that absolutely you can use both. In fact, Jack Hickey, if you're still watching, what do you think about this? I'm curious about what do you think about, you know, do you think it's more natural to say he was living in London? I'm curious. Tell me. Okay, let's do another one. Let's do a more difficult one. Okay? Oh my God, I rubbed off his face. Okay. Okay, here we go. Woo! Okay, that took a long time. I'm sorry because I'm writing backwards. Okay. You can come and stay at my place if you are ever in London. Okay, try that. Try that one. I'm curious about if anybody can get this one completely correct. Because it's quite complicated, because we have some pronouns, some possessives. Ever. He said you could come and stay at his place if you... Oh, no, Eva. Sorry. She said, I'm... no, Celeste. Sorry. He said you can come and stay. No, dear. No, sorry, not correct. Ooh, Arjeta. He said, I can go. Wow. Arjeta Bikiri. Very nice. You are number one, my friend. Very nice. Arjeta did all of the correct transformations. Very difficult, this one. Very difficult. So, and I'll show you why. I'll show you exactly why. So, first we have the U, right? We need to change this. So, he said that I, because he's talking to me, he said I, and now here we have our first verb. Now, as I said, we can use the present tense, we can keep this, because maybe the invitation is now, the invitation is in general. So I could say, I can come, or I could, both possible. Said, I can. Ah, but look at this. See, he's saying come, right? Come. But I don't come, I go. He says come, and then I go, right? So, he said, I can or could go and stay at my place? No, at his place. His. I can go and stay at his place if I... If I... Now, again. Here we have a verb. You can use present. If you want, if I am, or you can use past, if I was, both correct, both valid. Or, if you want to get really fancy, you can say were. You can use the subjunctive, I were, if I were ever in London. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 really important transformations. I think this is the most difficult type of sentence because you have to sort of think, you know, you have to think like another person. It's very difficult. There are not many students who do this first time. It takes practice. But it is something really important to practice because repeating what people say, telling stories about what people say is something that we do every day. Most of our conversation is telling stories. I did this, you did that, da da da, he said this, she told me that. It's, think about it. So this is very important to practice this. And I'm going to give you one more special thing, okay? One more special thing. Now, let's go back and think about the librarian. Maybe let's think about the librarian, okay? Now, the librarian. So I go to the library, and the librarian says, shh, don't speak. Okay, let's think about the sexy librarian. I agree, let's do the sexy librarian. So we go to the library, and the librarian, I go to the, and she's wearing glasses, right? Because I'm a man, so I'm imagining a sexy woman librarian. But maybe you're a woman imagining a sexy man librarian, right? Like really good hair, tight t-shirt, you know, the abs. maybe some glasses, you know, to look a bit intellectual. Deep blue eyes, you know. Okay, so we're imagining the sexy librarian, and the sexy librarian says, the sexy librarian says, "You've been a naughty boy. Your book is overdue." Do you know what this means? Overdue is like, your book is late. So she says, you've been a naughty boy. Your book is... okay. So now imagine you're telling this story to your friends and you're like, "Oh my God, I went to the library and exactly, Pavel, you must be punished. So you're telling the story to the friends. Now, when you're telling the story, you want to imitate this moment. You want to imitate the librarian. Now, when you do an imitation, you can't use this, the indirect speech. You need direct speech. But there is a special way, a very common way, to introduce this, okay? Which is to be like... or to go. And I know it's very strange, but hear me out, okay? So I use these, I can say to be like or to be go. This is a substitute for said or for said. So I could say, "The librarian said, 'You've been a naughty boy.'" Or I can say, "The librarian was like," because it's in the past. "The librarian was like, 'You've been a naughty boy.'" Or, "The librarian went," because it's the past. "The librarian went, 'You've been a naughty boy.'" Okay, so, and saying this, saying to be like or to go with direct speech is super common. If you watch any television interview or film or listen to a podcast, or if you listen to any native speaker, they will say this. "He went, and then she went, and then he was like, and then I was like." Very common. Very common, and more natural than saying "he said" or "she said," especially for imitation. So, you should practice these things. Okay, practice them. I don't have time to talk about the third thing. But what you can do now is you can go and listen to my new podcast episode, episode 7, which gives you the secret to fluency. It's for you. Totally free. 13 minutes and I give you the secret to fluency. And it's not anything weird. It's not a system or a book or a course. It's just exactly what you would expect. So I hope you take a moment to listen to the podcast and I hope you enjoy it. Okay, I have to go. I really enjoyed this class with you guys. I had a great time. Thank you so much for being the best students in the world. And big love to you all. I hope you have a great week. And I'll see you in class again soon. I'm Christian. This is Canguro English. I'll see you in class.
Bye. Bye.